بسم الله، الحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. It's nice to be with you today. My name is Ahmed Galal. I'm assistant consultant anesthesia. Proud to be in the cardiac team anesthesia. Today's lecture is about management of patients with pacemakers and automated defibrillators. It's not only cautery interference. The objectives of this lecture is to know the basics of cardiac implanted electronic devices, including pacemakers, indications of their use, anesthetic management, pre, intra, and post-operative anesthetic management, and some special situations where we meet these cardiac implanted electronic devices. A small history about these devices. It was first battery-operated pacemaker was 1958. The first automated implanted cardioverter defibrillator was 1980s. And it was then approved by FDA in 1985, and the rate modulation advancement in 1988. As you see, these dates are far away from now. It's not a new topic. It's an old topic that we have to know very well. To start with, pacemakers are basically or generally divided into temporary or permanent pacemakers. Temporary pacemakers include transesophageal pacemakers, transvenous pacemakers, transthoracic or transcutaneous. While permanent, that is the main concern of our lecture today, are implanted subcutaneously mainly in the left infraclavicular or right infraclavicular regions. They are implanted with batteries that give them a lifelong of about 3 or 10 years according to type of battery. And the new MRI compatible devices are now available. The component of an ordinary pacemaker, it is three parts. The first part is the pulse generator, that is inside a casing that is implanted in the infraclavicular region, an electrode that is implanted inside the myocardium, endocardium, or epicardium even, and a lead that connecting the two parts together. The electrode is has an extra fixation mechanism that prevent its dislodgement from the myocardium. Electrodes are either unipolar or bipolar. This is a nice idea to know. Unipolar electrodes, the cathode in unipolar and bipolar is inside the myocardium, is the part embedded inside the myocardium, as you see this part, for example, and this part. This cathode has to reach the electricity runs from it to the anode. If it is unipolar, the anode is the casing, like this one. But if it is bipolar, it is a nodule just in the same axis of the lead. It is this part. So if we see a nodule just proximal in the same lead to the cathode, this is a bipolar electrode. Okay, will this make any difference to us? Yeah, actually it will. As you see, the electrical field in the unipolar is so large, but in the bipolar it is limited to this small area. And this makes electromagnetic interference to the unipolar much more common. We can see it more common with unipolar leads than bipolar. This is how it looks. As you see here, this is the tip or the electrode, and this is a bipolar lead. The other thick part in the lead here is the shock coil. So the first message today is to concentrate in the following part. It is the pacemaker codes. We have to know the codes to be able to speak the same language. It's not accepted that someone tell me that the code of these pacemakers, for example, DDD, and I do not know what is this refers to. So the code is simply divided to five letters. The first letter is the most important, the chamber based. The second is the chamber sensed. The third is response to sensed electricity or sensed activity in the myocardium. Fourth is programmability. And the final is multi-site pacing. For example, the paced, the first letter is paced chamber. This might be atrium, ventricle, or both, or dual. So we will see A, V, or D. The sensed chamber, the second letter, it may be atrium or ventricle or dual. The response to this may be triggered or inhibited. Inhibited, this means that if the pacemaker feels the electricity of the myocardium itself, it will be inhibited. It will not give electricity. But triggered, it will give electricity. What might this mean? Why the pacemaker will give electricity to a myocardium that already has its own electricity? Actually, this to make sure that there is an electric impulse inside the ventricle or inside the sensed part of the myocardium. And this triggered activity, the pacemaker electricity just hits the R wave of the ECG. This means that it will not be of any use. It just hit the R wave where the heart is not responding, just making sure that this beat will be okay. The fourth letter is programmability. Some pacemakers are programmable. This means that we can change the program implied to the pacemaker or add many programs. And the most new or most important advancement now is the rate modulation, the R wave in programmability. This means that if a patient does an exercise or needs some more heart rate, the pacemaker is intelligent enough to know that these patients' requirements are increasing and start to increase the pacing rate to meet his requirements. The final letter, or the fifth position, is multi-site pacing, where we insert another lead in the atrium, ventricle, or both, just to make sure that it will be conducted, no beats will be escaped. Common examples of these codes include AOO or VOO. This is the asynchronous mode, where the atrium in the first example is the pace the chamber without sensing or response to it. It just gives atrial pacing. And VOO, it just gives ventricular pacing. Both of them are asynchronous, so there is no response to it. It's neither sensing anything. VVI, where both ventricle, the ventricle is both paced and sensed. This means that if the ventricle has its own electricity, the pacemaker will sense it and the response will be inhibition. The pacemaker will not give its own electricity. DDD or DDI. DDD, triple D is both atria and ventricle are paced and sensed. And the response is dual, inhibited and triggered. This means that the pacemaker will sense the atrium trying to beat or electricity in the atrium and will sense the electricity in the ventricle. It will be inhibited if it feels electricity in both, or it will be triggered and give the impulse imposed on the R wave of the ventricle if it is triggered. And the DDI, it is only inhibited, there is no trigger. Obviously, if it is a triggered response, it will be losing of battery of the pacemaker. It will just give an extra impulse for every beat, even if it is sensed already, will give an impulse, and this might deplete the battery more fast. The first examples are used in sick sinus and complete heart block, AOO and VOO. VVI might be used in complete heart block or AF. Triple D in AV and SA node disease. And the same is the DDI. Now, what is the AICD, or automated implanted cardioverter defibrillator? These are devices that combine the function of two or more devices. It combines the function of a defibrillator that is capable of doing cardioversion and a processor that analyzes the ECG of the patient. And most of these devices has a pacemaker capabilities, all in one device implanted in the infraclavicular region, for example. This is how it looks. As you see here, there is a thick part, a bipolar lead, as we said, with a nodule proximal in the shaft of the lead. And there is a thick part here. This thick part is the shocking coil that gives a shock to the myocardium if it gone to an abnormal rhythm. These devices are capable of defibrillation. For example, if there is VF or something, it will analyze this and decide to give shock. It gives shock and retains sinus rhythm. The other option is to do an overdrive pacing like that. In this case, the patient went to AF, atrial flutter, here, and the device analyzed the atrial flutter and decided to do overdrive pacing. It will pace the heart in a very rapid rate, reaching, for example, 300 or more. And this will make the impulse of the focus giving the AF to hit the myocardium in the absolute refractory period of the pacemaker. This will make the atrial flutter disappear, will vanish. It will try to hit it and it will not be effective and the focus will die. And then the pacemaker or the AICD will go back to the lower rate and pacing only the atrium in the normal rate of the patient. The AICD has also a code that we have to stick with. The first position is the shocked chamber. It might be atrium, ventricle, or dual chamber. The second is anti-tachycardia pacing, as we said, overdrive pacing. Might be also atrial, ventricular, or both. The third is tachycardia detection. It might be via electrocardiogram or hemodynamic changes. It analyzes electrocardiogram or analyzes metabolic variance or blood pressure if it is hemodynamic change. The final is anti-bradycardia pacing, where this is, in most AICD, they have an extra pacemaker actually inside the same device that enables it to pace the atrium, ventricle, or both. Now for the indications of CIEDs, or cardiac implanted electronic devices generally, pacemakers are indicated in some types of heart blocks, symptomatic bradycardia and bradyarrhythmias. ICDs indicated in some types of tachyarrhythmias, long QT syndromes, and Brugada syndrome. CRT, or cardiac resynchronization therapy, is indicated for low ejection fraction with bundle branch block, mostly in patients with hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy or dilated cardiomyopathy. For some more details, types of heart block that indicate the insertion of a pacemaker include second degree type 2 block and third degree, while bradyarrhythmias include sick sinus syndrome. Actually, this is the most common cause of pacemaker insertion, and it has many types. We should not forget drug toxicity here. Some drugs does severe bradycardia or hunting pacing of the patient, but this is mostly transient. It will not insert a permanent pacemaker for it. Long QT intervals and Brugada syndrome. I think we are all familiar with long QT syndrome. Here I will do some emphasis on Brugada syndrome. It is characterized by right bundle branch block with ST elevation in V1 to 3 with a curved T wave and J-point J-junction elevation. And it has a notch in the T wave or just after the T wave. This is a common syndrome that requires pacing. CRT, or cardiac resynchronization therapy, this is done via biventricular pacing of patients with moderate to severe heart failure, when there is ejection fraction less than 35%, and there is conduction delay between the right and left ventricle, disturbing the synchrony between both. So the right ventricle is contracting, the left ventricle is contracting, but without cooperation between them. This will decrease the cardiac output. And in these patients, it is found that if we succeed to do some synchrony between atrial contraction, ventricular contraction of the right side and left side, it will improve the cardiac output. It's done with sequential pacing of the atria and both ventricles. This is how it looks. As you see here, most of the CRTs has shocking capabilities. There is shock coil in the superior vena cava here, and another one here in the right ventricle. And there is one characteristic electrode in the coronary sinus. This is what, how can we differentiate it from other types of cardiac implanted electronic devices? So we have to know the indications, yes, because we have to know what we are dealing with. If I do not know the indication for the insertion of this pacemaker in the this exact patient, I will not be what is the pace, the original rhythm of the patient or why he inserted it. And so for whatever reason, if this pacemaker failed for whatever reason, I would like to know what will be the rhythm of the patient. Okay? There is something called pacing threshold. This is the lowest amount of milliamperes needed for capture of the myocardium. How much milliamperes should I give to this patient to make his myocardium responsive to me? There is many factors affecting this pacing threshold. Most of them metabolic, including hyperkalemia, hypothermia, hypoxia, and hypothyroidism. These factors will increase the threshold, and hence I have to increase the output of my pacemaker to make sure that there is capture of the pacing. Factors that might decrease the pacing threshold includes stress and anxiety, sympathomimetic, and hypokalemia, glucocorticoids, and hyperthyroidism. Problems associated with cardiac implanted electronic devices are variable. We have to think, like, if the patient is recent, should we exclude first that there is any complication after insertion of the device, complication related to insertion axis? I mean, we have to find an axis to a central vein to insert these devices. So in this example, there is tension pneumothorax after insertion. As you see here on the left side of the patient, there is tension pneumothorax after insertion of the device. We have to check for battery failure. It might be some diaphragmatic capturing or myopotential interference. The next step is to exclude microshock. I should think about microshock for every patient coming to OR with these devices. Microshock is electricity less than 100 microamperes that is directly reaching the heart via these type of devices or whatever devices reaching the heart, like central venous catheter, for example, and it can be fatal to patients with as low as 100 microamperes only. And we should think about electromagnetic interference. Actually, in this picture, there is another complication, that is electrode transfixing the myocardium. It is inserted from the endocardium and penetrated the whole depth of the myocardium, and it is seen on the epicardium. This is one other complication. Now, electromagnetic interference, this is electrical signals picked by the cardiac implanted electronic devices from any source of electricity nearby it. This is an example of electromagnetic interference we commonly see in OR, where the surgeon is using cautery. Here, he is using electrocautery, and this is the ECG trace of the patient. As you see here, the electrocautery is affecting the trace and the ECG. Meanwhile, it is not affecting the arterial waveform because the patient is not inserting a pacemaker here. This is a normal patient. The same idea applied to the pacemaker or a patient with cardiac implanted electronic devices. If whatever source of electricity or electromagnetic waves is nearby the pacemaker, it might affect it. It might do the same picture like that. And the pacemaker might feel it like the patient's own rhythm. If it is inhibited, for example, pacemaker, it will not give electricity. It has already felt the electricity coming from the patient. Or if it is an ICD, it might give a shock if it feels that this looks like VF. So this is actually an important subject. It might have devastating sequelae on the patient. Where we can find electromagnetic interference in the hospital? It can be found in many devices, including defibrillators, AEDs, in the MRI, in electrocautery in the OR, and even in household devices like microwaves, electric razors, and telephone transformers, and many others. Now the next step is, where should we encounter a patient with a CIED? First, for their insertion, where we meet a patient with heart failure, with symptomatic bradycardia or malignant tachyarrhythmia, that is coming to our hospital to insert a CIED, a cardiac implanted electronic device. So the first place is in the cath lab, and the anesthetic management should be tailored according to the patient's status itself. Next, after insertion of the pacemaker or cardiac implanted electronic device, we can meet a patient, for example, doing an operation or having an electroconvulsive therapy, or in the ICU or any part in the hospital. Okay, I hope you didn't sleep. Can we start the lecture now? Okay. I hope we can, inshallah. If anyone needs some help, I can just ask for some coffee. Now, anesthetic management of the patient. This is the core for anesthetic stuff, anesthesia stuff. It is subdivided into pre, intra, and post-operative parts. Or let's have the full picture here. This is our map. Pre-operative part is subdivided to assessment and preparation. Intraoperative is subdivided to monitoring and conduct, and postoperative. All has many subdivisions. We will talk about them quickly. First, we will start with preoperative assessment of the patient. As usual, training we use to see patients or assess patients with history, examination, investigation. And this is what we will do here. Objectives of the preoperative assessment is to answer these four questions. Actually, it is crucial to put these questions in my mind while I'm assessing my patient. The first question is this patient dependent on the pacemaker? This means what would happen if, for whatever cause, the pacemaker stopped working? Will I lose my patient? The second question is, this device is liable for malfunction. Is it now malfunctioning, or it is possible to go to malfunction after I am with the patient in the OR? The third question, what are the recommendations of the cardiology staff for this CIED device? It is crucial to know it. Actually, it is the core of management of these patients. And the third thing is, what are other comorbidities? It is not the end of life to have a pacemaker in one patient. It might have renal problems, he might be ischemic, he might have many other things. So putting in mind these four questions is crucial to answer the four of them just before touching the patient. First, we will go for history. As we said before, we have to see the specialist evaluation form. Here in KMC, there is a form that is filled with cardiologist or electrophysiology specialist. We have to see it and see whatever recommendation he is writing. In the patient, himself, there is a pacemaker bracelet that might be found in some patients. We can see the maintenance recommendation if the patient is regularly doing maintenance for his pacemaker or not. We can revise the cause and date of insertion. This actually will give me an idea about the battery, how long it has been working in this patient. And anticoagulation is an idea that we should revise in this patient, but it is not per se is indicated for this patient by cardiologist for just the insertion of pacemaker. Pacemaker does not warrant anticoagulation anymore. But the same patient might have another comorbidity that needs anticoagulation. So we have to revise if he is receiving any anticoagulant. And we have to revise whatever comorbidities and medication he is receiving. Then we will go to examination. We should feel the pulsation of the patient, palpate for pulsation and regularity of pulses, and compare it to the mood of the CIED inserted. We should check for tenderness over the pacemaker implant itself. Sometimes there is tenderness, meaning that there is infection and acidosis might affect conduction of these devices. There is many investigations important in these patients. First of them is 12-lead ECG, where we can find some useful information. First, the pacing rate. We should compare it with the report of the cardiologist or the bracelet in the patient that is written the number. If we find a big difference between the record number of the pacemaker and the actual number in the ECG, the heart rate I mean, this would give me an idea that there is battery failure or battery is weakening. For absence of electrical spike, this means that either it is not functioning at all or it is an inhibited type or other types like ICD, for example. Then we can see a loss of capture. There is obvious electrical pacemaker activity without any cardiac activity. There is no QRS complex after it. And here the same happens. So this is loss of capture. It might show us that there is change in the pacing threshold in this patient. Other information include the chamber pace, that this is roughly can be seen via ECG. And the next investigation is chest X-ray. It is crucial to do a chest X-ray for these patients. It will give me many, many informations. First, I will exclude insertion complications. Second, I will know the type of the cardiac implanted electronic device inserted in this patient, and I will know the lead type and hence the liability for electromagnetic interference. As we see here, there is two pacemaker electrodes. This one has a nodule just before the tip of it. This means that it is bipolar electrode. And there is no thickening in the wire at all. This means that it has no shocking capabilities. And this gives the idea that this is a pacemaker. This is not an ICD, neither a CRT. There is nothing in the coronary sinus. As we see here, there is two shocking coils, one in the superior vena cava and the two other in the right ventricle. And the lead type is, electrode type is bipolar. And there is nothing seen here in the coronary sinus. And so this is an AICD. Next, we can see here what we are looking for in every X-ray of this patient, and a lead or electrode inside the coronary sinus. This means directly that this is mainly a CRT. It has also shocking capabilities, as we can see here and here. Other investigations include electrolyte and metabolic profile of the patient, because as we said, it might affect the pacing threshold of the patient in the OR or anywhere we can meet the patient. For example, hyperkalemia or hypokalemia. The next step, we now finished preoperative assessment. We will go to the next step, that is preoperative preparation of the patient. There is few steps to follow in the preoperative preparation. The first is to know to make sure that this patient was seen by a cardiologist or cardio electrophysiology specialist, to know what the report the cardiologist written already, what are the recommendations of the cardiologist, and then to try to identify the manufacturer, type and mode of CIED, any contact number if there is anything happen. If present, we should turn off all rate and anti-tachycardia responses. Actually, it's better to put our patient in asynchronous mode, or at least we can just increase the pacing rate. This will increase the cardiac output a little and will help us in oxygen delivery of the of our patients, to maximize oxygen delivery to our patients. Next, we should correct any electrolyte abnormalities, and we should be ready with all emergency drugs and a crash trolley with another pacemaker transcutaneous, for example. We should confirm the magnet response. In the past, it was a routine use to put a magnet on the pacemaker of whatever patient coming to us in the OR. Actually, the magnet have one of four responses. It might turn the patient to asynchronous mode. This is a favorable response, we want it. It might give us another option, that turn off the pacemaker transiently, turn it off permanently. As you see, this is devastating. And the last option, it might do reprogramming if I'm not familiar with the pacemaker type. And reprogramming, it will be a surprise program. We don't know what program. I'm not a cardiologist. So you have to choose one of these. Which one, which of which, no one knows. This drives the recommendation of the American Society of Anesthesiologists that magnets should not be advised practice in all cardiac implanted electronic devices, not by us. Actually, the only one allowed to put a magnet on a pacemaker to reprogram it is a cardiac specialist or cardiophysiology specialist. So no more magnet, just leave it for experts. This is an important message, no more magnets. The next part is the intraoperative part. It is, we will start with monitoring as usual. And as you see, the most important part of monitoring is an anesthetist. Anesthesiologist is the core of the monitoring of any patient in the OR. Actually, frequent palpation of the patient pulsation and even the use of pulse oximeter or arterial wave form are crucial to make sure that the pacemaker is functioning and giving regular heartbeats. We shouldn't forget to disable the artifact filter in the ECG. We should be able to see the pacing spike in the patient. Central venous catheter and pulmonary artery catheters are better avoided if the device was recently inserted less than 2 weeks. And it should be safer after 6 weeks. It was found that insertion of these devices might give rise to the dislodgement of the electrode. Other monitoring options, including end-tidal CO2 and TEE, are safe options for use. Back to our map, the next step is conductive anesthesia. We have either regional or general anesthesia to take care. Regional anesthesia is considered safe unless there is anticoagulant use. And if there is any anticoagulant use for whatever reason, we should revise our guidelines for regional anesthesia. General anesthesia, first induction. Induction agents are generally safe, excluding etomidate that can give rise to myopotential. Myopotential actually will do the same effect like electromagnetic interference. It might do some electromagnetic interference. Succinylcholine is better avoided as it, for the same reason, it may do fasciculations like myopotential interference. But defasciculation of before succinylcholine with an undepolarizer make it safe and priority for the airway. And it is safe to put the patient to asynchronous mode just prior to the use of a succinylcholine. Maintenance of anesthesia, we should consider avoiding the use of sevoflurane, isoflurane, and desflurane, the famous inhalational anesthetic, in congenital long QT syndromes only. We should avoid nitrous oxide if the CIED is recently inserted, just to not to make buckets of gas in the insertion site. And we should avoid drugs that suppress the AV node, not to make the patient pacemaker dependent. Electrosurgical unit use, according to the FDA, 255 of 456 adverse events happening inside the OR are related to electrocautery. So it is not a small issue. More than half the adverse events happening inside the OR are related to electrocautery. Why it is related to it? Actually, it can do many problems. It can do inhibition of the CIED with electromagnetic interference. It can do random reprogramming. It can cause myocardial burn. It can cause unindicated shock if the device perceives it as a VF, for example. There is two type important in electrocautery. I'm talking now about unipolar cautery, not bipolar. Unipolar cautery has two modes, cutting or coagulation. The cutting mode is different than coagulation in only one thing, that it is continuous. It is not interrupted. Both gives electricity to the tissue with a very high frequency, reaching one or more megahertz. But in the cutting mode, it is continuous. So it gives more heat and destroy tissues. This means cut tissues. While in the coagulation mode, there is interruptions between the pulses, and this interruption causes less heat, just enough for coagulation, not for destruction totally. So, generally speaking about precautions of electrosurgical unit or electrocautery, bipolar is considered safe because it has the two pools in the same part. It will not give electricity to the CIED. Monopolar pure cut is better than coagulation, as we explained. Because coagulation, these pulses might be perceived by the device as patient on rhythm or VF. Patient on rhythm, it will not give pulse if it is a pacemaker, or VF, it will give an unnecessary shock to the patient. We should use short bursts, for example, less than one in 10 seconds. Electrosurgical unit current should be the lowest functioning. This is the responsibility of both teams, the surgical team, the nursing staff, and should be revised by anesthesiologist. We should never ever have the generator between cautery and ground plate. Otherwise, all electricity of the generator of the electrocautery will pass by the cardiac implanted electronic device, and all what I'm fearing of will happen. We should never ever have the generator between both. It's better if we are not using it in nearby to the device, not within 15 centimeters from the device. We should change the pacemaker mode to asynchronous if possible. And emergency transcutaneous pacing and emergency drugs should be ready. Actually, this is crucial to every patient, to be ready for the worst to happen. We have to prepare ourselves, yeah. We have to take care of our patient, yeah, but be ready for the worst. Now we are talking about post-operative. Actually, these patients should be managed in an ICU with pacing capabilities. We should avoid shivering in this patient, looks like myopotential interference. We should turn on the AICD that we turned it off prior to surgery and reevaluate the pacemaker function, and rate enhancement may be reinitiated if we turn it off. Some special situations we can meet a patient with CIED-N include the use of defibrillator. Actually, the PADS use is better or recommended than paddles because PADS allow us to put them far enough from the pacemaker. For example, for the anteroposterior position of PADS. It should not be used within 15 centimeters from the CIED. We should select the lowest effective energy, and it still can cause endocardial burn if the electricity select the lead to pass through and directly hit the myocardium via the lead of the pacemaker. The next situation is electroconvulsive therapy, where asynchronous mode is should be selected to avoid myopotential interference. In magnetic resonance or MRI, we should absolutely contraindicated for patients with cardiac implanted electronic device just to step inside the unit of magnetic resonance. Now there is MRI compatible devices where these patients are thought of like having more MRIs in the future, they should insert an MRI compatible device. Lithotripsy is contraindicated only if the pacemaker is implanted in the abdomen. And we should avoid focusing the beam of the lithotripsy on the device. Radiation therapy is generally safe, and we just consider repositioning the device if it is in the radiation field itself. And radio frequency ablation should be avoided to directly contact the pacemaker and keep it as far as we can. Now the interesting part is CIED and KMC. What we insert here is actually everything. Cardiologists here can insert every type of pacemaker, and this is what is happening now. This device was inserted here. It is, as you see, an ICD. It has shocking cables and it has a bipolar electrode. Who should we contact? I think we should contact Dr. Nadim Raja. He's a cardiologist and electrophysiology consultant. He's welcome to contact him anytime. Or we can contact Mr. Mohammed Al-Shumarani. He's a cardiac physiology specialist and a cath lab manager. And he is also welcoming to contact him anytime. Thank you. This is everything. And now for questions.